Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to the happiest podcast on earth, LorcanaCast, your premier Lorcana podcast. And it is time, Simba, my boy. Rafiki has revealed the truth. We finally have the rules on how to play this card game that we knew nothing about for the past umpteen months. So no longer will everyone that creates content be speculative. We now have enough discussion topics to actually kind of parse through these quick start rules, look at cards, assess deck types, assess card values, all kinds of really cool stuff. So the whole team is here. We've got Chris, we've got Skeff, we've got Cap. How's everybody doing?
Fantastic, buddy. We got rules. I made it.
Wow. I thought his head was going to explode.
I don't think Jason was going to make it to this day.
I think Jason was going to make it at all, guys.
Yeah.
We should take in a poll. Will Jason make it to rules?
I would have voted no. So
I would have voted no as well, Jason.
So, Sugi, before we dive into the rules, I want to say one thing. After reading it on paper, I want to say, Ryan and Steve, I think this game is good. I like it. I'm very happy with it. So I think our patience has been rewarded.
Or it might have been, you know, preemptively struck by the GTM magazine.
Thank you, GTM leaking. Magazine. They're like, wait, so, what happened?
Yeah.
Release so the rules.
For people who are listening, it is April 10th, is a Monday. And earlier today on Twitter, somebody got their hands on the GTM magazine for May, which had a small section built around Lorcana. It had some new cards. It kind of explained a majority of the rules, probably I would say about 60%. And we went crazy over the internet. It hit Twitter. It hit Discord. So I don't know who the initial original post was from, because there were like three people on Discord posting it and they said it was coming from a third-party source. And then people on Twitter were getting it from another third-party source. So it's a magazine that most people can purchase. So I don't know who the original credit went to, but it doesn't matter, because then there was an article that went live and it has everything from thegamer.com, and we'll post this in our show notes. But there is a full pamphlet with the quick start notes, which covers pretty much everything we need to know and what we're going to be talking about on this podcast. So get ready, strap in. We are going to talk about the rules for Lorcana, and we're going to be able to actually educationally determine if cards are good or not instead of just guessing wildly in the dark. So it's really exciting. Before we get going, I know most of us have read through these rules and kind of come up with our thoughts. What do you guys think about what we've seen so far before we actually start breaking down the rules individually?
60 card deck, 4 cards per. You know what I mean? Like four copies. Card lot, 60 card deck. Like, I like that. That's just like the standard. That makes me happy.
I overall like the rules. I think it's, like we talked about before, a very good first TCG game. And the one mechanic that I'm fairly interested in and excited about is the fact that you can't challenge standing characters. So that's something we'll have to dig into. That changes a lot of the math about how these games work.
Yeah. Again, I think they hit the nail on the head. They said this game was very accessible. Like Skeff and Bates pointed out, it's easy to pick up, and it's harder to master. And I think for people who have a TCG history, it's going to be really fun to get into the weeds once we have all the cards to really kind of figure out how to break this game wide open.
All right, so everybody strap in and get ready, because we are going to start learning about how to play the game. So first off, a turn, we're just reading straight from the manual. You can read along if you want. There'll be all kinds of pamphlets I'm sure you can find on the internet in some capacity. But a turn is divided into two parts. Each player takes their whole turn before passing to the next player. On your turn, take these steps in order. First part is the beginning phase. Number one, ready. Ready your exerted cards by turning them upright, basically untap. Number two is set. Check for effects that happen at the start of your turn and follow their instructions. So if a card says at the start of your turn, draw a card, you would do it right here. And then number three, draw. Draw a card from the top of your deck. The first player skips this step on their first turn. So like traditional trading card games, the first player gets to go first and do whatever they want. The second player gets to draw a card and then do whatever they want. So in Magic terms, if you're deciding who goes first, who goes second, it's usually called going on the play or going on the draw. And the first player gets to play with no extra card. Second player gets to draw the extra card and play with that, you know, extra resource, which who knows what you get. Moving forward, then you move into the main phase. So this is going to be similar to a lot of trading card games, kind of like One Piece and Digimon. There's only one main phase. You don't do main phase combat, main phase two. It's just one main phase. And once per turn, you can put a card face down into your inkwell at any time. So you take a card from your hand. If it has one of those swirls around the top part on the left side, you can turn that card into a ink in your inkwell, which we were kind of sort of speculating about in previous episodes, how that worked. We were wrong. We thought that you had cards with a swirl meant you had to pay a specific color. And if it didn't have a swirl, it was colorless. Come to find out, basically everything in the game is colorless. There is no color. You take the card, you flip it upside down, you play it with its back facing up, and then you just tap cards in your inkwell to pay cost for anything that you want, for abilities, items, songs, characters, whatever you want. Moving forward, additionally, you can take any actions listed below any number of times in any order you want. This allows you to take full advantage of what your cards can do in combination with other effects. So here are the actions you can take. You can play a card. You can use a character ability that doesn't require them to exert. You can use an item ability. You can take an action with a character that's been in play since the start of your turn. These including questing, challenging an opponent's exerted character, using an ability that requires them to exert. So I'm going to break this down really simply. In your main phase, you can play a card. So you tap your lands or you tap your inks and you play a card for whatever its cost is. Or you can use a character ability that doesn't require you to tap them. So if it says, pay three mana, like shift. You pay X mana, X resources to shift something onto this character. Or you can use an item ability like we've seen with the mirror, the magic mirror. You pay four, exert the item, draw a card. And then with character abilities, when it says you have to have a character that's been in play at the start of your turn, that means if you've played a card on this turn in the main phase, you cannot do these things I'm about to mention. However, if the card was in your possession at the start of your turn, basically you played it in a prior turn, then you can quest, which means you tap a card and you gain lore. We'll talk about that later. Or you can challenge an opponent's exerted character, which means you tap your card to attack someone's character that is exerted or tapped. We'll talk about that later. Or your third option is to use an ability that requires them to exert. And Elsa is a really great example. Her ability says tap or exert this card to exert somebody else's character. So essentially, main phase, you can do any combination of things. Like you can tap a character to quest, then you can tap a character to attack, then you can play a card, then you can activate an item. Then if it's, for example, maybe the rabbit stopwatch, that item would give the new card you just played rush. The new card with rush can now attack. Then you can play an action card, then you can play a song card, so on and so forth. You can do whatever you want in whatever capacity you want. As long as you follow those rules, basically playing cards, you can do it any time. Using characters, you have to wait until they've been on the board for one turn. So with all that, beginning phase and main phase, what do you guys think about the game? It seems like there's a lot of really interesting options. There's a lot of different ways to play, and it gives the commander, the pilot of the deck, a lot of flexibility.
Yeah, so I think the rules, it's the base of it is very straightforward. I mean, getting the 20 lore, you know, I guess, from the cards we've already seen, the basic are either going to be rush decks, right, where you try to get out a whole bunch of low-cost characters that have lore pips that you could exhaust to gain lore fast, and you don't really care if they get taken out because you're just trying to rush and trying to score those points early. Or from a lot of cards we've seen, there would be a lot of control, too. So again, you know, saving up to get, you know, get your big pip characters out there and protect them somehow, whether there's through ward or something else, and not tap them, not exhaust them until you know you're going to swing for the win, right? So those are like the two main archetypes of decks we'll be seeing, and I think a lot of the initial gameplay would be revolved around those two strategies. But definitely the rules lend themselves to a lot of different future mechanics, future card types, future deck types. It's very combo centric. So I'm excited.
Yeah. So I like Glimmers having summoning sickness. Again, I like I don't think we went into it just yet, Sugi, but I like the starting hand size. Again, you know, it's typical for most games. First player doesn't draw first, but you know, you're going to draw. So you got a good hand size with a 60 card deck. Again, you can only go after cards that are exerted, so that's good as well. Like Chris said, you know, it's gonna take a lot of strategy, and you know, it's going to be different styles, bring different fights. So it's going to be very interesting.
I'm just excited to get the concept of the rules so I can kind of start wrapping my head around the cards. And then you just start looking for like combinations. But for me, it's one of the things where actually having the full fundamental concept of the concept of when the game is like, all right, it's a race. It's a race to 20. And that's really cool to find out, like, there's the end goal. And it was just fun to see the rules kind of getting surprisingly announced today. But it makes me more excited for it now, knowing that it's kind of a combination of a bunch of different games that I've played. So that's why, like, it'll be fun. I'm looking forward to it.
I love the fact that it's going to be very hard to get mana screwed or your mana system to be disrupted in this game.
That's very true.
It still can happen, right? It's not the – so I think that kind of leads to a deck building and decision making of the game too, about what cards you're going to use to put in your inkwell, right?
So it's not huge, yeah.
It's not that you're always going to take one card and put it in your inkwell. It's that you still have to, you know, build your deck right, so you have enough cards that you have the chance to do that every round if that's what you want, your deck wants to do. Plus, which of those cards are going there, and then some of the more powerful types of cards. You know, it seems like I don't know if we're going to get there or not, Sugi, but a type of card called Songs, which seem like pretty powerful actions.
Oh, we're gonna get there.
Yeah,
okay, okay. We're getting
fine.
One jump ahead of the law, man. That's all, and that's no joke. These guys don't appreciate I'm pro.
So anyway, so songs, as far as we can see so far, you know, and maybe in a lot of actions, it seems like can't be used to be placed as inks. So that's an interesting balance mechanic that I think is a cool part of the game.
Yeah.
And it also seems like keywords like ward are going to be very powerful, at least in this base set, just going off the initial look at this rule. So you're going to have to find a way to deal with that. And it also seems like having some kind of removal, whether it's spot removal or board wipes, is going to be pretty important too, to kind of, you know, obviously prevent your opponent from in that race to 20.
So we should probably clarify a couple things before we move forward. Game is a base race to 20 lore. The first player to reach 20 lore or more wins the game. And if your deck runs out of cards, you lose the next time you would draw a card. So mill is a thing. However, I don't know if they're actually going to utilize cards that force your opponent to discard cards off the top of their deck. But unlike certain games where if you run out of cards, you can still keep playing, that's it. Like, if you run out of cards and you have to draw, you're done. But the segue I want to bring up is talking about the inkwell. And the way it works is your inkwell is where you'll put ink cards face down. You'll use the cards in your inkwell to pay the cost of cards you play from your hand. You can put any card from your hand into your inkwell once per turn. The card you choose must have the inkwell icon, which is that swirl around its cost in the upper left corner. And then basically what you do is you show your card, you put it face down, and then you tap your cards to pay costs. So something that's interesting about this game in particular that everyone kind of was guessing and nobody really got right was that all of your cards, for the most part, as long as they have that inkwell icon, can be used as a resource for the game. So there's no land cards, there's no second deck like in One Piece with the Dawn cards. Everything in your deck, depending on how you build it, can be used as mana. So it really helps reduce mana screw, mana flood, mana drought, whatever you want to call it. What are your guys' thoughts on this? Because we've seen this ability in the WoW TCG, and it was really beloved that you could just take a card and go, hey, this card is now a resource. I don't need it. I don't even want to play it. It's useless, but I can use it as a mana.
You know, again, I think it's really, really a great way, especially for somebody who's just getting into TCGs, to experience a mana system. I think we've discussed this in early episodes before that many people, maybe not hardcore Magic enthusiasts, will admit that the resource system for Magic is not the greatest. It's a, you know, 30-year-old system or whatever it is at this point. It's prone to either getting too much of a resource or too little of a resource, which could determine the whole outcome of a game. So it's a mini game within itself to make sure you have enough resources. So the fact that here you're going to begin that base level resource each turn is great. And it means you get to play the game. You know, again, unless you just put, you know, unless your deck is some other weird well, I shouldn't say weird, we don't know that much yet, but a different type of deck where you're not trying to put out build that much resources. So you put a lot of non-swirl cards to your deck. You're going to want to probably put out a card per turn, right? So I'm excited. I mean, I think that's a great way. I'm just thinking about ways I can teach my kid this game. Very straightforward. You know, it's, once per turn, you get to put a card out there, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's also going to really teach people how to effectively, for using my game's term, charge an energy. So like picking a what card you want to send to your inkwell is gonna, you know, be very important long term, because obviously once you put it there, then you don't have access to that card. So you know, it's gonna create helping players understand like deck ratios and kind of keeping an understanding and a bit of a log as you're playing of at what different decision points in your tree you have about, well, if I put down this Brave Little Taylor Mickey now, you know, am I okay with that when I need him in say like two or three turns to try and go for game potentially, you know, knowing that you may have two or three more left in your deck. So I like the decision making aspect that's going to come from this game with the resource system. Now with it being one per turn, you know, like Chris said, like Magic and Dragon Ball and games like that, it makes me reevaluate a lot of cards, and we can talk about that at a later point, but it means that with this being a base set, that games potentially, and we'll get there later when we talk about questing and lore and all that, games could potentially go long, which, you know, it means we're playing the game longer, but hopefully, you know, we can get to that longer point to play cards like Brave Little Taylor. So I'm curious to see how the game's going to play out once we start playing it.
And just to piggyback on that kind of a little bit, the mana ramp that we've seen already becomes that much more impressive, right? So the mana, some of our earlier episodes, we talked about how we weren't convinced that the mana ramping cards, like the clock, I think the watch. Is that one of the ones?
We actually haven't seen any ramping cards until today.
Yep.
With the song.
The song, yeah.
But I thought
the song.
What was the
watch gave you rush.
It gives him rush.
Oh, they gave me rush. Okay, thanks. Yeah. Okay. So we've seen the song today that is a ramping card.
Yes. So one jump ahead for those who may not know. One jump ahead is a 2-cost action song. And what's interesting about songs is they have a secondary casting cost. So one jump ahead states, put the top card of your deck into your inkwell face down and exert it. So you can basically get an extra ink in your inkwell faster. So that's called mana ramping. What's interesting about songs is it's a special type of action that have a certain, so I'm looking for, alternate cost. So one jump ahead says a character with cost 2 or more can tap or exert themselves to sing this song for free. So instead of paying 2 ink, you can just tap a character and play the card for free. Now we'll talk a little bit more in the future about why that's important because of challenging and whatnot. But apparently all songs have an ability that says a character with cost X or more can tap to sing the song for free. So not only will they have a variable casting cost, but they'll have a variable singing cost, I guess we could call it. So that way, if you don't have resources available or you don't want to spend resources because you have a big play, you can tap a character to fulfill the song. They sing it, and then you get the card effect for free, which I think is super cool.
We have another card that I would argue is mana ramp as well that was revealed today, which is Just in Time, right? It says you may play a character with cost 5 or less for free, and that's a 3-cost card. So that's, in my viewpoint, it's a type of ramp as well, right?
I was going to just kind of a little piggyback on that, on the inkwell system, where it really comes down to deck building and then kind of the availability of cards you have in your deck. For me, because that's fascinating, because your opponent doesn't know what cards you chose to use as ink. So, like, what do you have in your discard pile?
No, they
do.
Like, they do. You reveal it.
I guess, wait, even on the song one, do you still reveal it?
Well, so you can either tap a character or you can pay mana. Oh, yeah, yeah. It says put the top card of your card
face into down.
Your inkwell face down.
It says, ooh. Yeah.
Right.
You know, so what? Like, they might not know. Yeah, I don't know. You might not know
either. To discuss point, yeah, you don't know, like,
right,
what's going, so...
Like, you look at, yeah, that's, I mean, I expect that we do have pretty good rules. I expect there still to be a comprehensive rules document.
This is true, right?
Which will have those really, those really, really top level questions.
FAQs already built in.
Right. So that we'll have stuff like that about, well, when a card says that you do something, it'll explain what are public or private zones or what are zones that you can look into.
Like, what's public knowledge?
Yeah, all that kind of stuff.
I like that every card serves a purpose. I think that's that's cool. Like if you build the deck, you're like, all right, I'm gonna have at least 25 cards that have ink on there. You're like, all right, cool. The odds of hitting one pretty good. And then, I mean, it's a cool, fun mechanic when you go, especially for deck building, right? That makes me happy.
I think you reveal the card, even though it doesn't say so. I might be wrong, but in the quick play rules, it says to put a card in your inkwell, show the card to your opponents, and then put it face down into your inkwell as ink. So I know that the song doesn't specifically say reveal it, but it does still use the same vernacular. You know, you take the top card of your deck, put it face down into your inkwell exerted.
But the song doesn't care if it's a swirl or not, though, right?
Correct. The song just takes the top card of your deck and puts it face down.
Which makes it more powerful.
Bypasses it. You should know what that card is. You don't have like this mystical card that you have to put to the side. Like, I can't look at it. No one can look at it.
Well, the only other argument is I believe that probably your equal will be public information. I think that would be public information for both people. But just to play devil's advocate, the other argument for that is that, you know, obviously, when you're playing a normal equal card from your hand, they have to check and see if it's a swirl card or not, right? So that's why you reveal it. That's why that mechanic's there.
So you're not cheating.
You wouldn't have that restriction because, again, the card doesn't care if it's a swirl card or not. I'm just playing devil's advocate. I think it's probably going to be public information because that just makes sense to me. It seems really weird to me to have cards in front of me in a separate area that I cannot look at in that way. Typically, you can't reorder them. Like in Fab, you aren't allowed to reorder or change things around just for certain reasons. But yeah, I think it's going to be public information.
My favorite part of this by far is players over time are going to have to learn when and where to turn cards into ink. So just because a card can be an ink doesn't mean it should. And it's going to be very interesting to watch as players learn when a card should be used for resources, when a card should be used for questing, when a card should be used for challenging. Just because a card can do it doesn't mean you should. I started learning that tonight when I was playing Flesh and Blood, and it's fascinating because you can pitch cards for defense, you can pitch cards for offense, you can pitch cards for resources, you can put them into your arsenal for a future play. And it's like, wow, one card can do multiple different things, and making that delineation for each card in your hand every turn is fascinating, because making a misplay can be very detrimental if you just, you know, put the wrong card in the wrong place. I'm not saying Lorcana is going to be like hyper detrimental. I think it'll be much more forgiving, but I love the fact that this is definitely one of those card games that's in that easy to learn and lifetime to master kind of games where you can probably teach this to most people of any age in like 10 minutes. Super duper easy. Hey, take a card. If it has a swirl, turn it upside down. Boom, you can use it to pay for your cards. And then if you attack, so on and so forth. If you turn it sideways for questing, so on and so forth. Easy. But when you get into the really interesting nitty gritty of deck construction, assessing the cards in your hand, especially since when you're building a deck, we have confirmed you can have four copies of any single card. And if you have different names of a card, so for example, in this guide, you can have four copies of Elsa Snow Queen, which we have seen. And you can also have four copies of Elsa Queen Regent, which we haven't seen. Very interested in that. So multiple names do not eat up the same slot. It's kind of like Pokemon. You can have different types of Pokemon in your deck as long as they have different names. I believe that's right. Isn't that Skeff? You can have like...
It's actually the opposite. So like you can have like four Charmanders total.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
It's So you can mix them all up. You can be from every set, but you can have a quantity of...
A four in total.
Four. But I mean, I think the cool concept, like, you could just build an entire Mickey Mouse deck is what it's looking like right now.
I don't like that idea. Not loving it.
But you could, so...
But you can.
Cool. You could, but it would be in red and purple or amethyst. And
you know movie, someone's going to do it. And also, like, there's going to be an all-Stitch deck, probably, because all the different Stitch
characters.
You know what I mean? Like, that's the thing. Like, someone's going to do, like, the fun, like, kind of gimmicky thing, right?
I don't see this language in the actual document, but the LorcanaPlayer.com, where...
It's in the rules where it says, like, deck building, where it's, like, four copies.
Right, but they have this other part, which I don't see this part anywhere, but the website has. It says, your deck can't have more than three copies of any single card. However, you can have more than four copies of the same name, but not the
correct, yeah.
Not that's more a, than that's same, a glitch.
Not more than that's the a, four that's the same version.
So The quick start rules from the gamer specifically says you can have, your deck cannot contain more than four copies. So you can have one, two, three, or four copies of any single card.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know why it says three on the website. That's odd.
Yeah, they're probably just wrong.
Yeah, okay. I'm gonna go with the actual rule sheet.
Because both the rule sheets say, four.
Yeah, both say four.
And even what they're saying doesn't make sense because like, you can't have more than three copies of a single card.
Exactly. So yeah, we assume sense. That. someone.
Typo.
Okay. Bad translation, right?
The only thing I was going to say earlier, and I assume you read that already, Sugi, but the other part that I think is really cool is that you can do any of your actions in any order during your turn.
Yeah, that's how you combo. That's how you're going to combo.
That's going to make it really cool. Item,
yep. Tap that, then play this card. Like, that's how you're going to combo out. Like, that's how someone's going to come up with a crazy big dumb combo.
Yeah.
That's how it goes.
We already were talking about a really dumb combo. So if you have Maurice and Belle.
You got to read the card. You got to tell people what the cards are.
Okay. Maurice is a card and Belle is a card.
Oh, no, you know what?
I'm just kidding. All right. No.
Evil Sugi's back. Sugi's back already. Evil Sugi's back.
They don't mill Sugi.
Why do you say I'm evil? What about like silly Sugi or hungry Sugi? I need that Snickers. Can you quickly like, you know, DoorDash me a Snickers?
Millie Sugi?
Oh. When are you going to get there? Are you going to get the win condition in the game?
I'm trying. There's no mill condition ability right now.
But it's a win condition, though.
I mean, if they give me cards to do it. So Maurice basically says if you quest, the next item you play gets a cost reduction of 2. And then Belle says if she quests, the next item you play has a cost reduction of 1. So the combo is, we'll talk about questing here in a second. But basically, you quest with Maurice, you quest with Belle. You get a -3 cost on the next item you play. Then you play the rabbit stopwatch, which costs 3, now 0. Then when you play the stopwatch, Maurice says every time you play an item, you draw a card. So now you +1, basically replace the stopwatch. Then you tap the stopwatch for 1, and the next card or a card you play this turn can have rush. So you can use that to play a card from your hand, give it rush, tap it, and either attack and challenge, do something really silly. It's not cheap. Don't get me wrong. Like, that is a very expensive play in one turn. But let's talk about challenging and questing, because this is going to be a very, very interesting part of Lorcana that's extremely unique, not to the game, but just how you play the game. Let's talk about questing. The pips on the side of the card are lore. Gasp. Didn't see that coming. Holy smokes. What were they thinking? It's technically called lore value. I'm going to call them lore pips because reasons. To quest with one of your characters, you tap or exert them and you gain lore value because of their pips. Dun, dun, dun. Super hard. So basically, the way you win the game is hit 20 pips, 20 lore, and you win. So what you do is you get characters on the field, you exert them to quest, and you add that lore to your lore count. Very simple. However, challenging is the opposite end of that spectrum. So how do you stop someone from questing and just automatically winning the game every single turn? Questing is how you gain victory points. Challenging is how you get rid of characters. So you can only challenge characters that are exerted. You cannot challenge untapped or ready characters. This is really interesting. Also, damage is exactly the way we thought it was. It's just like Magic. The interesting thing is when you tap or exert a card for any reason, be it questing, challenging, using Elsa to exert herself, to exert someone else, you are in your most vulnerable state. You are now able to be targeted by other people who can attack you and most likely banish you to the discard pile. So it's interesting because a lot of people have already started speculating about building up this huge board of characters with a bunch of lore pips, not exerting them, and then in one turn just tapping everything for 20. I don't think that's going to work because there's a lot of tools to get rid of that, but that is something people are speculating about, where you can just put on, you know, a bajillion Mickey Brave Little Taylors because he's got 4 pips, and then, you know, you tap all 4 of them for 16 and then some other stuff for an extra 4 and boom, you win. I really don't think that's a viable strategy, but the idea here is you win the game by tapping your characters to quest, you remove other characters by tapping them to challenge, and then using cards and abilities to exert characters so that they're tapped makes them vulnerable to attacks. Absolutely brilliant. Very interesting. What are your all thoughts on this?
So going off your, because you mentioned this to us behind the scenes in our group chat about the people's idea about waiting. One, doesn't Mickey cost like 8 ink? So if you're going to try and play like 4 or 5 of them, right? Like, you don't think, like, in what world in a competitive environment or even at your locals is a player just going to sit there and let you like just build up your wall for 8, 9, 10 turns and not do anything? Like, I understand you can't, like, they're going to have like some kind of, again, like I said earlier, like removal is going to be very important. And like you said, any kind of disruption or protection spells like ward, it's going to be very important in this game. But I think it's kind of naive to think you're going to be able to sit there and just like try to Exodia obliterate in one turn.
So I think it's a fear of newer players, because on paper, it does make sense. You could build up this wall. And of course, in the rules, it's very clear. You cannot attack a ready character. So if your opponent has no way to exert your characters and no removal, what's stopping you from building up a wall and then just auto winning by, you know, exerting all your characters and questing? Very logical. I do understand. However, when you actually play a trading card game, there are lots of mechanics built into the game system to prevent that big giant wall from happening. There's going to be ways to remove characters from the board. We've already seen Elsa. She can just tap down a thing and then you can swing into it. There's a ton of different stuff we've already seen that makes the wall stall nigh impossible. I mean, it's something you could build, but I don't foresee it being something that's just going to automatically win because you're this unstoppable force. So I do understand what people are saying. On paper, it looks like, why would I not just not play the game and instantly win? But I think once you look into the game mechanics, the game structure, the tools that are available, you'll start to notice that unless your opponent is also playing a wall stall style deck, it's probably not going to be very functional.
And we've already, again, I think every deck's going to have some type of removal built in, right? That goes past, well, like, I shouldn't say that, but removal is going to be here in the game. We know we have Dragon Fire's 5-cost removal that could banish any character, right? They don't have to be, it doesn't matter if they're exhausted or not. That just banishes chosen character, right? So we have that already. They revealed a card that's a steel card. We don't know the text of it yet, but it's Fire the Cannons, which probably targets a weenie character, you know. That's I would assume, again, doesn't matter if they're exhausted or not. So I think we'll have plenty of tools to be dealing with characters that aren't challenging yet, right? So it's just how you're going to build your deck. Are you going to try to out lure them, out quest them, out aggro them, or are you going to try to control? We also talk when we have Elsa, right? So Elsa says you could exert chosen opposing character. So again, if you have a Aurora deck where you're trying to like set up this big five, you know, put that 5-cost character out there, give your other characters ward, just build up till you have 20 lore pips on the board to swing at one time, however combination you get that, and protect them with Aurora. You know, a purple deck that has access to Elsa can tap your Aurora, kill her or banish her, and then go after the other characters, right? So we already see a lot of interactions with the cards that have been revealed about how that's pretty unlikely that somebody's going to sit back and build up 20 pips. Again, I think it's going to be more the thing of either they're going to just keep trying to rush you down, you know, come in, wait the turn, attack as soon as they can, then have you challenge them back. Or it's going to be, you know, a lot of these control cards trying to control the pace of the game and get in there. They're challenged when they can.
It also sounds like if you're trying to do this wall stall deck we're talking about, honestly, it seems very boring to play and very boring to play against. Like, I think that the game is designed to have like interaction, like not if you play like old, like 2002, 2003 Yu-Gi-Oh! Like, I don't think we want to go T-set pass and just have like 30, 40 minute game ones, because that's something else we haven't even got to yet, is that Lorcana is like most games is 2 out of 3. So if games are going long, that's my concern when we get to OP, is being able to finish a match in time.
I straight up won't lie, I'm going to be running quadruple Cheshire Cat decks, because 0-3, 2 pips, if you challenge and banish him, he banishes you back.
The card is disgusting.
It's so good. When I saw that and saw the rules, I was like, okay, there's a stall deck. I can already see it. That you can easily build stall decks. Like, again, you're not going to be able to just leave a bunch of cards untapped and unused. If you're going to run a stall type of deck, it's going to be cards with high pips and all kinds of weird defensive abilities. Because like Cheshire Cat has 0 attack, but his ability is when he's challenged and banished, you get to banish the thing that killed him. So you slap him down turn 3 and you just keep questing him as much as you can.
Well, no,
because he doesn't kill things that attack him. He kills the thing that banishes him. So if you're smart, you would swing in with like a 2-something and then you kill him with like a 1, like a Tinkerbell, who's like a 1.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yep. I think she's like a 1-3 or whatever. So But even still, he's taking a body with him. That's good.
She's
but
a 2-4.
He's a 0. Okay, yeah, she's a 2-4. She's
2-4 for 3.
So the idea is you have a character for 3 mana that gives you 2 lore, 10% of what you need to win, that will take a body with him. That's not very nice. And if you run 4 of them, guess what? You're going to have 8. If you get them to the field, you're going to have 8 lore in your pool, and you're going to take 4 bodies with you. Hopefully, you're paying 3, and you're taking bodies that are bigger than him alongside. So it's just gnarly. You don't even have to attack. You can create these weird questing defense decks that just kind of mess around with your opponent. Kind of like you could bring him and you could bring Cruella. And, ooh, just bouncing stuff back to their hand when she dies. Cheshire Cat banishes things that banish him. It's just, ooh, so gnarly. Love it.
Also, Weenie Rush. I mean, if we think about that as a concept, but if you look at the cards that have been revealed so far, the Captain Hook has 1 pip for 1. That's the only card I think that is a 1 for that has 1 lore pip as 1 cost. So, you know, many other cards, you know, Elsa's 3 cost has 1 pip. Olaf is 1 but has no lore pip. So again, I think that they're going to be very hesitant to be printing a lot of cheap cards that actually have lore pips. Cruella has 2 cost with 1 pip. So, you know, you're not getting multiple. I think a lot of those lore pips are worth a good amount of resources, right? Generally, you're not going to be getting a really good ability and lore pips on normal cards, on common rarity cards, which is probably a good thing. That's not going to have us just having somebody like consistently put down 1 cost and swing the next round. You can't deal with it, right? Otherwise, that would just make it really, really good. Okay, each player starts the game by drawing 7 cards from their deck into their hand. You draw 1 card per turn, but the first player doesn't draw a card on their first turn. You can also mulligan your starting hand by putting as many of those 7 cards in your hand back to the bottom of your deck without showing them. You then draw from the top of your deck until you have 7 cards again. You reshuffle your deck if you do this, but you can only do this once. You also don't do this step in your first game. Oh,
it's like when you first start out, don't worry about it. You just play the game for the startup. So if you're very first playing Lorcana, that's why they put that in there.
You also don't do this for your stepping the first in your like oh like your first like game ever.
Like your first time ever.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Don't confuse the mulligan. Just play your hand out.
See sure. Right. Yeah. Sure.
Yep. If little Jimmy and little Tim, you're playing a game, ignore all this means. Rules. Just, yeah. just not, draw 7 yeah. cards and go. Yeah,
not game one of game three. Not game one.
Right.
Of three.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
No.
There's that flesh and blood player trying to game the game.
No. I didn't read that part earlier. I said it for the first time.
How can I cheat this mulligan thing? Here's also something, guys. I want you guys to look, double check here. But do you guys see anywhere about a maximum hand size?
7.
Nope. I don't think there is one.
I don't think there is one.
Pokemon.
Just like, yep, exactly. Right. Oh, I'm excited about that. You're like, I'm gonna draw all the cards.
let's be honest. You're gonna burn through that hand real fast because you're gonna be playing lots. You're gonna try and hit curve every single turn and turn yep. one of those cards into a resource, into an yes. ink.
Yes. Every turn.
This game is going to make card advantage really good. And Plus, blue yes. has got some really interesting card effects to get you that card advantage. Yeah. I'm liking it.
I really do expect there'll be some sort of board wipe card. Cause at the end of the day, like
there has to be,
cause at the end of the day, like everything is such like a field mitigation where like you have to win by having things on the field. And if for some reason your opponent just keeps taking one character, and they have a board built up, there's got to be a way for you to have some sort of comeback.
I bet your green's going to get a giant Shroonade where everything just bounces back to your hand.
Yes, right. Please.
There's got to be a way for you to like turn the tide when you're playing. Like otherwise, if you're just like, oh, well, he has 5 creatures and I have none, I'm just going to lose the game because I can't play enough characters to catch up with them.
Yeah. Again, I think we've seen like 40 cards, maybe 50.
Yeah. We still got like what, 200 something to go or something like that.
Yeah. There's a bunch spoiled. I mean, we'll get to those probably in a future episode. Like we saw a Yzma. We saw a
Hercules.
Gaston was referenced on LeFou. We saw Maui.
We're going to see a lot of the cards come. What is it?
Gamma.
So end of the month, they're going to be. So Gamma is a convention for like store owners, and they're going to be doing legitimate like play tests. So they're going to have like, and I bet it'll be the 3 starter decks. Yep. They'll be play testing sure. with.
Yep.
But we'll see all the cards in the starter deck, which is another you know, potentially another 90 cards that we haven't seen yet.
And what's fun is we never actually went over the original D23 cards. Lots of cards we haven't actually gone over to try and
now figure out. Now we can.
Out. Yeah, we've specifically waited for some rules so that we can kind of, you know, figure out how good are these cards. And hilariously looking at those D23 cards, I'm pretty sure a good majority of them are going to see play, if not all of them.
I fully expect all of them to see play out the gate.
They're very, very good. They all have something unique to bring to the table in each color. And I think it's cool that now we know how to play. You can kind of see the theme inside of those six cards. It's like,
yes.
Yeah, they really chose well. I think they chose very, very well. So something I did want to talk about that I loved is card. There'll be a term for it. Someone will come up with a term to coin. But I guess what I'm going for here is card usability. So something we were talking about, when you look at the card, any card realistically now, especially characters, there's generally three things you're looking at. One, can you use this card as an ink in your inkwell system, which is your top left, does it have a swirl? Next thing is lore. How much lore can this card produce? I used to play a lot of Marvel versus Capcom 2, and so the term was coined a battery. You'd have characters that didn't do a lot of damage run around the map, run around the screen, and you would just throw out normal attacks. It doesn't matter if they hit. It doesn't matter if they connect. It doesn't matter what happens. As long as you're pressing a button, you're gaining super meter. And then that character will eventually die. And then you bring out your actual character you want. And those were called the beaters. And you just dump all of your super meter and you kill your opponent. So what's interesting about Lorcana is you have all of these potential uses for a card where you could turn a card into an ink. You can use a card to gain lore. Or you can use a card for its attack and defense stats to try and neutralize your opponent's tools on the board to make their board less effective, your board more effective, and give you an edge in eventually hitting that 20 lore. So I'm really fascinated now that, you know, actions and items and songs don't really correlate, because actions, items, and songs don't create lore. They don't attack. They can be used as ink sources, but realistically, your items, actions, and songs, the money for those cards, the value, is the text printed on the card. So characters are kind of the meat and potatoes of the game. You have to pick and choose. When do I play this as a character? When do I use this as an ink? How do I set up to score, you know, lore? Or how do I set up to deal damage and remove my opponent's options for them to actually gain lore? And I find it fascinating, because most cards in most trading card games outside of like Flesh and Blood and Dragon Ball Z traditionally do like one thing. So if you think about Yu-Gi-Oh! Or Pokemon or Magic, your creatures, characters, monsters, Pokemon, those are things that attack, those special abilities, but they don't have, you know, trap abilities or instant speed abilities or trainer abilities. You have to have specific cards that do specific things. Whereas your Lorcana characters can be both mana and a character that does something on the field. And I love it. I think it's really cool.
Did you say items can't be inkwelled?
I said items can.
Okay, yeah.
But they generally don't want to be. They're low enough cost to the ground where, for example, there's a Dinglehopper card that was revealed. It's a one cost card. It has the swirl, so you can turn it into an ink in your inkwell. But it has an ability called Straighten Hair. You just tap it to remove up to one damage from chosen character. And something we should mention is items stay on the board until they're destroyed or removed or whatever. And you can use their activated abilities immediately. They do not have summoning sickness. So you can play a Dinglehopper and then immediately remove a damage. I mean, the longer the game goes, the more value you get out of that card. It's
right.
It's like by turn three, it's great. By turn five, one mana to have taken five damage off is just nuts. Like, super good. Super duper good. That could mean an entirely brand new character at full health. You kind of hope to get Dinglehopper out on turn early. One or turn two. Yeah.
Well, there's nothing that removes items yet, right? We haven't seen anything that removed items.
Right, I'm sure there has to be.
We haven't seen one though, right? We haven't seen one, right?
No.
We haven't seen it. But when you look at an item, an action, and a song, they currently don't create lore. So that's kind of out of the question when you're talking about, you know, viability for what can it do. They can't attack. They have no attack and defense ability. And most of the items, actions, and songs we've seen do not have the swirl, which means you cannot turn it into a ink in your inkwell. So that's why I was saying most of the time, 99% of the time, these cards, if you have them in your deck, are there for the printed text on their card. You use it, you get rid of it.
I mean, deck building in this game is going to be so much more complicated than like on the base level it seems, because you need to make sure you have enough cards that even have lore pips, right? Well, like of a certain type to win the game, because yeah. you can basically, you know, if you don't build your deck right, you can make it so you can't win the game.
Oops,
right?
Or you just rely on decking your opponent out with that way. You just keep knocking everything off their
way.
Board.
There's no way.
It would take way too long.
You never know, mate. That could be something like deck, I played. I'm going to knock out all your characters.
If there's a deck archetype like that, that's going to be pretty weak. I mean, in all these games, you get those kind of weird things.
It would take a miracle. You'd have to draw the nuts. They have to draw nothing.
You'd be totally reactive the whole time.
But no, but you're right, though. The concept of, like, I think eventually for, like, this is just, like, a competitive play concept, but, like, you'll get to the point where, like, someone will figure out, like, the exact amount of, like, ink cards you need to put into the deck. Like, all right, you need to make sure ink cards. Yeah, like, it gets more like, all right, do we need 20 ink cards? Is it 17 ink cards? Like,
yeah.
What
probably
do you need?
Half.
Yeah.
No, I think you need less. I think
you No. You're going to need at least half.
Yeah, I'm kind of with Siggy because I was looking at the numbers and thinking you need like 25 to 35.
But I guess that's true, right? Because I guess it doesn't matter. Like at the end of the day, like if the card is useful, I mean, you're right. I guess it could be most of the deck, right? Like it just depends on like.
There's also probably a point you stop turning cards into ink, right?
Yeah, I think after like probably 10.
A sweet point because.
Turn 10, you just stop.
You won't ever have
it. Depends on your costs.
And your deck type, I guess. All those things are relevant. But generally, I would say you're not going to have enough cards in hand to have 20 ink on the board, right? Mm-hmm. At that point in the game. Unless that's your strategy, where you're really going to try to put everything down. Hopefully that rush you can't actually. You can't quest, right?
No, rush is only challenge.
I thought rush was only challenge.
Oh.
Yeah, you can't rush the quest.
Never mind.
So, okay, yeah, so
that's,
so
thank God.
So you can't have.
That's the whole aggro part of it, right? Yeah. Like the red aggro, like, oh, I'm going to haste. It's just haste.
Inevitably, there will be cards.
It's
cards
not
that will...
haste, because haste, you can tap for whatever you want.
Oh, okay.
That's not as scary. Rush doesn't, you can't.
Yeah, rush is just
anything.
Challenge. You can't quest rush.
Okay, can't quest. Thank you, Jesus.
Inevitably,
I'll double check the rules.
There'll be cards.
No, you're right. I just read it. You're absolutely correct. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Well, inevitably, there'll be cards that can come down and quest the same turn, whatever they have haste or whatever, but those need to be really expensive and really rare, right? Because I bet
we're gonna see Mill in purple amethyst,
not for a couple sets.
No, it could be in the first set. I'm gonna go with Sugi.
I don't think it'll be amethyst, but I guarantee there'll be some sort of Mill card.
When do we see Millstone and Magic?
This card, the top card of your opponent's deck, and that'll be it.
No, that doesn't. Terabad.
I'm just saying, it'll be something really basic, mate. They're not going to be anything fancy.
We haven't seen a lot of yet. I guess I shouldn't say that. We've seen cards that banish other characters, you know.
Yes.
But we haven't seen disruption other than that. So they haven't revealed disruption about.
We just saw ramp. So
right. You know, but you know what mechanic so just got really that. Good with this one drop inkwell per turn is shift.
Yes.
Shift got really good guys. Yep. And then that stitch, really which has three lore for a technical like four cost for a shift.
Well, five. Well, no, you shift for four. So I guess
it's a six cost. It's a six cost with a four shift.
So you do it on turn four.
Yeah.
Yes. Turn four.
Yeah.
Or so three if you ramped.
Yeah. Or if you ramp. But that's the thing, right? Shift gets really good for the acceleration of what quality of cards you play.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Also, that three drop or that five drop Aurora that could shift for three. Or you can get her out with Maui, that card that allows you to play a five drop. Five.
Yeah. Just like Maui. Yeah.
Woo! That's huge. Yeah. That's how you can shift into like. I don't know, Hades really quick, right? You just play a simple thing, then you play the Maui, then you get the bigger thing, and then you just keep going.
All these cards that use exerting another character to do something, that also, because of the rule set, now becomes less powerful, right? Or becomes more of a risk.
That's vulnerable,
But now we know that that's how people can actually get rid of your characters.
Exactly.
So that's, for example, Stitch says whenever you play a card, character with cost two or less, you may exert to draw a card. So if you play
I'm still doing it.
I mean, it's still really good, but then that leaves you open to do that, especially if you're exerting something that has a lore pip, right? You got to think about, well, you know, what we're going to do. Do we know about, this might be another comprehensive rules thing, but we don't know about how abilities stack. I can't see any examples that
What do you mean by abilities stack?
Yeah. Who gave the example with the bell and the Maurice, where you have two different abilities that will work together?
Well, no, but I mean, like, what if you have two bells?
Yeah, then they'll work.
Yeah, so they all stack.
Yeah.
But how do you know that?
Because it says whenever this character quests, you pay one less for the next item you play this turn.
Right.
So if you tap two of them, then when you pay one less.
The last part you said that they could rule either way. It could be that it only does the one less and it doesn't stack.
It says you pay one less for the next item you play this turn.
Right.
So if they all tap, then it's -4 for the next time you play. But
One for each one or for that card name?
Or do they consider that as a fact that just applies once?
So it's like a static off just that one, yeah.
So I don't see the difference because you haven't played the item yet. So if you have the stopwatch that you would cast for three, if you tap three bells, what's the next time you're going to play? The stopwatch. Well,
yeah, but they could
-1, -1, -1. That's
but, the right, but they could rule it where it's just -1, -1. So then you're paying two for it. It's not free.
That would suck.
That seems stupid.
It doesn't.
That'd be terrible.
It's the balance of the game and how they made it.
All right, I'm going to bet a booster pack. It's not like that at all.
Jeez.
Given that we were wrong about the last one, I'm not going there.
Right. Oh, okay.
I can't tell from the card so far. It seems like it probably does lean more to what Sugi's saying because there are not a lot of abilities that stack in that way. We still have a limited card pool, but it seems like they're pretty.
I'll just say if that's the way it is, then Belle and Maurice seem like terrible card designs.
They're garbage.
Because they both say the same thing. Yeah. Whenever this character quests, Belle gets you one less for the next item, and Maurice gets you two less for the next item. So if it only relies on a singular entity, like you cast the stopwatch for three, and I quested with Belle and I quested with Maurice, you can only pick one of those. What the heck?
What I'm saying is, so if you have four bells and they all quests, it could be that because that ability came from whatever's called, what's her ability called? Can you read it? It has a name.
It's Tinker.
Tinker. So they can say that Tinker applies once. So that it still is. I mean, so the stopwatch costs two then. So I don't. How much does Bell cost? I mean, it's Bell a question costs, of
Bell's three.
It's a question of the balance of you know. Three to minus one item, and the only item, the most expensive item I think we've seen is three, right? I don't know if
the mirror are costs low four.
Four. Oh,
the mirror costs four.
Thank you.
The mirror is super expensive, and then it costs four again.
No, magic mirror.
No, yeah, two.
It costs two to play, but it costs four to do the ability, which wouldn't affect that.
No.
But the four to play,
just the cost to play it. Yeah,
it's a question about how they balance the game. I don't, you know, I mean, like. Yep. And even they may even rule it that you can't go to zero. I don't know. I don't think that's likely, but these are all things that would be covered in the comprehensive rules.
Yes.
Agreed. I believe it stacks.
There we go. Thank you,
Sue. Well, we will find out later,
Sue. Well, we'll find out at Gamma.
I'm going to go see you.
I feel like it'd be a really dumb maneuver for all these things that make sense that are so streamlined. But if you have multiple copies of a card, it doesn't work. Like,
but for example, Ward, we know Ward basically stacks because of the way it's worded is that, you know, the other characters gain Ward. So
the
like,
card that Chris is, here's a good one, is Hades Sinister Plot. This character gets +1 something for each other villain to play.
One
so
pip,
if you have two,
plus
two Hades, pip. Isn't that +2?
Yes.
Right.
No. Hold on. Wait,
No,
that's wrong. No. It's this character gains +1 for each other villain.
So if you have two, each Hades
would give
amount.
Each other +1.
Yeah. There we go. That's what I was looking for.
It's like Aurora. She gives everybody else Ward, but herself. Yep.
Herself. So that's what you still have to do.
So you need two, so they
protect each other.
Yeah.
And then you give your opponent a big fat smile and hand over the Snickers because they're going to be hungry when they see that board state.
No. I don't agree. I mean, we gotta see the comprehensive rules. I think Aurora. I don't think you. So you guys. Am I understanding you right? Do you think of two Auroras out there? You can't target either of them.
Correct, because they each give each other Ward.
No, that's broken.
language.
I apologize.
Yeah.
Wait. Hold on a second, guys.
There's no way.
Opponents
there is a way.
Them except to challenge. So you could still challenge them.
Yeah, you can still challenge.
Yeah. Yes.
But you need to get a tap first.
Abilities.
But you can't also them. So that, I mean, that, so that all you have to do is sit there and never attack them until you build up the thing. I don't.
Yes. So you do blue green wall stall.
We got to see Conference of Rules. I do not like
well, that. Also, at all. Hey, the Aurora thing can also be the embrace can also be bypassed.
How?
When it's something that doesn't target that card individually. If it's more of a
thing, a board
it's true.
Thing,
right?
Then it targets everyone. So like it's okay. It's just like it's fine. You know what I mean? Like this, your other character.
How many games? So
like, and that costs five, Chris. Like
that Fab would have had cards
expensive. No. She costs three to shift, so you got to remember. Yes. You could shift her in, which means there's got to be a cheaper version of her somewhere.
There's probably the peasant version of her
somewhere. Does Magic even do that? Does Magic even have, if you have combos, could be like, okay.
Yes. Yeah, Yu-Gi-Oh absolutely does.
Why no? Yu-Gi-Oh, you can't take much from Yu-Gi-Oh.
Pokemon does too. Wow.
I'm not saying Beagle's bad.
A once per knife in the back episode. Comment from
I don't mind somebody. Yu-Gi-Oh! It's the rules of Yu-Gi-Oh! So much different.
Yu-Gi-Oh! Players are cheaters.
You're not wrong, but
it's a question of
Pokemon had this exact same thing. There was so many stall decks.
Yes, there were. Waylord.
What we're talking about here is each Aurora Dreaming Guardian a Aurora's unique not that character. OP.
Like she's fine, but
your other character, like is she another character, or are there each of them? You know, are each of them still considered to be the same character?
I believe it's another character.
You're saying that such authority. But we don't know that.
I'm gonna go with Yu-Gi-Oh.
I now believe that there is no, you know, you can only have one now. Clearly, I don't. It doesn't say that anywhere. I think you have two Auroras at one time. I do believe that, but I still don't know that they're going to be considered to be separate. Characters.
I'm gonna need to put the song from Tangled. And at last I see the light. And it's like the fog is lifted. And at last I see the light. Then the background here, trying to figure out what the heck's going on with. Is a character an only single iteration of itself, or can you have two of the same card on the field?
Well, I believe you can have two of the same card on the field. I do believe that now, because I think they would have said that in the rules we've seen. That's a basic of the game. I just don't know that. To me, I still believe they are the same character. But they're different
iterations, I believe. Okay. Yeah. Well, it is getting late. We have been talking for quite a while. So let's wrap this thing up. Last thoughts from the team. Obviously, we have got a lot to talk about, both for card, just assessments, deck construction, all kinds of things. But we don't want to take too long of everyone's time. We appreciate everybody who's joined us for this episode. So... Skeff, what are your thoughts so far after talking about seeing the rules, reassessing cards, looking back at what we've seen so far? Do you love it? Do you hate it? McDonald's or Burger King?
So I feel I should apologize to that talking closet. It seems pretty good now.
Oh, no, you don't.
We will be signing everyone's wardrobes at Gen Con. Oh,
absolutely not. I will be eating everyone's wardrobes at Gen Con. I don't care how much it hurts. I will
get back in that wardrobe, sir.
No. I'm going to eat my way through that garbage. That is bogus. I can't say where it's a family-friendly show, but hootenanny. No, absolutely not.
But basically, though, having the rules out and then seeing more cards and knowing that we're going to get almost probably half the cards released at the end of the month, because, you know, people are going to take pictures, even though they're going to say not to probably, but we're going to get a lot more information. But knowing the rules and knowing how the game works is really reassuring, because at the end of the day, now I'm like, oh, I know the rules. This now seems like my deck building brain starts like working, and I'm excited. Like, now that I have the rules and I can wrap my head around how it's going to work, it has me more excited to start cracking packs and building decks and knowing I don't have to worry about opening up, oh, a fire energy, oh, a blue land. Like, there's no dead cards in the pack anymore. That is nice.
I agree.
So I like it. I'm looking forward to it now more than if they had waited to release the rules.
All right. What you thinking, Cap?
I ate very well today. Today was a good day. I am hangry no more.
In the immortal words of Ice Cube, today was a good day.
Jason's hunger has been satiated. We're safe, everybody.
For 2 weeks till Gamma.
Crap.
But no, I mean, like, again, this game seems like a deck builder's dream. Just from playing it, there's a lot of decision trees that I've talked about earlier. I'm very excited to play the game. Something we didn't touch on because we ran out of time is multiplayer. That seems, you know, it's not just 1v1, but we can all four of us play, you know, at Gen Con together.
Bring your $20 bills. I'll bribe you.
Oh, goodness. I am very excited to see where this game goes. And now, like Scott said, I've already sat down, read every card, and started deck building and getting ideas. So I am very excited to play this game.
All right, Mr. Bates, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, if you can't tell, I'm really excited. Again, something I'm really excited about, too, that is in the Quickstart rules is that we are going to have league nights. They put that in the Quickstart rules, which I think is great, again, for building community. They already thought about that, and they already have prices planned for local play. So, again, I think that's awesome, and I'm just really excited to get the cards in my hand.
Nobody answered my question, McDonald's or Burger King, but that's okay. I forgot.
Neither.
Sugi, what do you think?
You want In-N-Out.
I will
That's
take
true. I want In-N-Out or Carl's Jr. I accept Carl's Jr.
Okay. I will take a Five Guys.
I'll take Five Guys. Take. Yeah.
No, that's not fast food. Oh, come on. We're talking about fast food with a drive-thru. Five Guys does not have that.
Okay, then I will take Panera.
What?
Panera has a drive-thru.
Does it have a drive-thru?
Yeah, mine does.
Not all of them do.
All the new ones do, and I will take. I have like eight of them here in town.
All right, I'll Mr. take the fancy pants. All right, well, I
turkey bacon.
What do you say? What do you think, Sugi?
I think the game looks awesome. I'm really excited that they revealed a Yzma because I'm going to be playing that Kronk Yzma combo. It's going to be super fun. I think the biggest thing that excites me now is we finally can stop being speculative podcast number 347 and actually kind of look at the game and legitimately start to assess, like, are these cards good? Are these cards bad? Like, I legitimately think Olaf is a pretty good card for early game and obviously a pretty bad card late game. But because he produces mana, I wouldn't hate drawing him late game because I just flip him face down as a resource and then play all the big cards in my hand. Jumba's looking good. I mean, it's really nice to finally know what the heck we're talking about. And I think that the game is pretty well designed. We'll talk about this later, but I have a very interesting hot take. I think evasive might be a very dangerous/toxic ability because it says only characters with evasive can challenge this character. So if your opponent doesn't have any evasive cards or ways to interact with them, those brave little Taylor and evasive cards like Tigger and Goofy, you can kind of just quest with them freely and your opponent can't challenge them with anything that doesn't have evasive, which is like, oh, ew, okay. But I'm sure there'll be answers. I'm not really worried about it. Again, we've only seen a small slice of the card pool. But they really did well. I think that overall, based on the small card pool, the minimal rules, the limited amount of time we've had, this is probably going to be a very fun game. And I'm starting to see why all these media outlets are saying that this game is coming after Magic and Pokemon, because it really has a lot of potential. Whether it's balanced properly, whether production is high so people can buy it. Like I was talking to one of my local game stores about Lorcana, and they said, we'd love to carry it, but we're afraid that we're going to get allocated too little and then we won't be able to get product for like 2-3 months and then the game will die. And I'm like, that's fair. We should look into that because I believe they said they're going to produce more and they're like, I'll talk to my distributor. So like, it's got a lot of good things going for it, but also talking to stores on the ground, they are legitimately concerned that they won't be able to actually support the game. So I hope that somewhere out of Gamma or Gen Con or somewhere, Ravensburger tells the entire world that, hey, we're beefing up production so you don't have to worry about it, especially since it's being sold on Shop Disney of all places, for Pete's sake. Like, if you can buy it there, you should be able to buy it anywhere, I think. Yep. I'm really excited. I think it's going to be fun. And keep an eye out. We're going to have more episodes. We recorded one with Chris talking about building community. And I think now is a great time to talk about that in a couple of weeks when we launch that episode. We've got Gamma coming up here in a couple of weeks. So we'll definitely have an episode about that. So we've got a lot of interesting Lorcana stuff in the pipeline. So make sure to stay tuned. Follow us, subscribe, like, do all that stuff. If you're listening on YouTube, if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Google or Spotify, just make sure wherever you're listening to keep it tuned into the Lorcana cast, because we've got a lot to talk about, a lot of laughs to be had, a lot of snickers to throw at people to curb the hangriness. and just some great conversation in the future. So thank you everyone for joining us. We will see you next time. And as always, remember that Ohana means family, which means nobody gets left behind. Nobody gets forgotten. So we will see everyone next time.
Gotta eat to live, gotta steal to eat. Tell you all about it when I got the time. One jump ahead of the slow pokes. One skip ahead of my doom. Next time, gonna use a nom de plume. One jump ahead of the hitman. One hit ahead of the flock. I think I'll take a stroll around the block.